Here we are again, looking at the MG, and I'm just having a look at the overflow pipes for the carburettors, and these only get used if the carburettors flood, so they're basically just an emergency measure, but they stop the fuel going all over the manifold, and quite a nice bit of design in that sense. Unfortunately, this one has rubbed through on one of the air boxes. These are only attached to the car. I don't know how they would have been when new, but only attached on mine with two bits of hose just hanging on there. I imagine they would have had more clips when new, perhaps. But the issue I have with these is that they finish about 6 inches in front of the manifold downpipes. So if you get a carburettor flood, like happened to me at speed, the pipes are discharging fuel all over the downpipes. You get a nicely atomised spray all up the underside of the car. So that's not great. I decided, therefore, given the damage and the slightly poor exit position, I decided to make some new ones. So I've attached mine together with clips, and I've also added a little bracket on there which I can lock tight to the heat shield by. So hopefully that will now actually exit just to the side of the downpipe and avoid getting any fuel up the exhaust system. Just a little bit safer. I'm hoping today to get to the point of actually being able to run up the car and do the adjustment, because I'd quite like to leave it standing overnight and then see that there are no leaks in the morning. We need to have a look at how we're going to do the adjustment, because there are various different ways, and this here to start with is a 1970 manual, so the year my car was registered, and it gives actually in some detail a description of how to synchronize the carburettors and adjust the mixture. And this is a very simple device, so you've really only got basic mixture adjustment and idle speed adjustment. Obviously you have the slow running control set up, but again, that's not complicated. The manual actually says that a carb synchronizing tool such as that is ideal, but you can just do it by ear, so listening to the mouth of the carburettors. And I'm not so keen on that, so I probably will use this device. You basically place this over the mouth of the carburettor that you're checking, you adjust the air valve to get the float somewhere in the middle of the sight glass, and set both carburettors the same by adjusting the idle screw. There's a good description of how to do this as well in the notes that came with the service kit for the carburettors. There's more detail in the SU tuning handbook. And again, it describes how you can do this by ear, just with a listening tube. That's quite simple. Shows the adjustment points and what should happen when you've got it right. That basically, when the mixture is correct, when you lift the test buttons, the engine speed should momentarily increase and then just sit slightly higher. Rich mixture will cause the speed just to increase when you lift the test button, and too weak will just make the speed drop away. So it really is quite simple. The Haynes manual as well gives a really good description of general adjustment and setup of the carburettors, so that's a good guide. So you can listen to the carburettors, you can use the, probably preferable, you can use the vacuum gauge. There's another method as well, and this is an SU toolkit, and in there are these tubes and pointers, and you can fit these up to the dampers, the damper pistons, so one in each, and then you can see that the pointers can be aligned and you can quite effectively synchronize the carburettors that way. So what I'm probably going to do is use the vacuum synchronizing gauge to begin with, and then I'll fit these up, because what you can't do with the single vacuum gauge is see what's going on higher up the rev range. So when you open the throttle, you want to see both dampers lifting together. Likewise, you want to see them returning to the idle position together. So that's something else we can check and just be a little bit more thorough. Anyway, so that's something of the various ways of doing the adjustment, and we'll look at it in some detail on the car. So I think we're about ready to try and set the carburettor up now. And you can see here my new overflow pipe working place. The air cleaners sit really very close, so it's been necessary just to reprofile them a bit, but it's worked out. You can see there's some heat wrap around them down there. They exit pretty close to the exhaust manifold, but they now finish to the side of it. Before, they were well down there, but right in front. So of course, as you're driving along, any fuel that should go down them wash straight back over the exhaust. So it should now go past the hottest part of the exhaust system. That's the idea anyway. And as you can see, my bracket has worked out. I've lock-wired the bracket to the heat shield and properly fixed them at the carburettors this time, so much better. Fuel hoses are all back on. Before I start up, I'm going to just turn on the fuel pump, let it fill the system and check for leaks. Basically, it should junk away for a few seconds and then stop once it's filled up. So we'll check that before we start up. New hose for the vacuum, for the crankcase breather. New line for the vacuum advance down to the distributor. All looking very much tidier. Few adjustments to make before we can try and start the engine. Obviously at the moment all the linkages are loose, which is the condition you want at this point. However, the throttle springs are on, so both throttles close hard against the stop independently. These here are the stop screws. These ones underneath are the cold running high idle control, and they work on the cam of the slow running control, which you'll note lowers the jet. It's important to remember while setting up, if you make an adjustment to the jet height, you need to make sure that the jet tube is pushed up against the adjusting nut, because there's only a spring on the tube that holds it there, so it's possible it will hold off. So that's important to remember. Basically, what we've got to do to start with is lift the damper. The manual says to take the dashpot off completely, but we can lift the damper. We can then see the jet tube, and we need to bring it up level with the bridge of the carburettor. So I'm going to show you how I'm going to go about that. Having done that, we can then make sure that the needle in the damper can fall freely as normal. Just checking to see it isn't sticking, and we can then adjust the idle screws just to get her started, and similarly the mixture two turns open just to get us started. At this stage I'm not going to reconnect the slow running control. It's a warm day, the radiator is warm to the touch. I think it'll start without. So likewise, the throttle cable's off at the moment, and we'll do the setup first. So I'm just using one of the test dowels from my toolkit to do this, but you could easily just use a screwdriver and lift the damper. Both jet tubes are now level with the bridge of the carburettor, flush with it. So we're now going to open each jet adjuster, two turns that's anti-clockwise to lower the jet. I'm now going to set the idle screw. So what we're going to do is, bearing in mind that the springs are on the throttle levers, I'm going to wind out each idle adjusting screw until I can see they're clear of the lever, and then bring them back so they just touch, and open the throttle one turn of the adjusting screw, both sides. So at this stage you need to make sure that the high idle adjusting screw for the slow running control is backed off, so it's not interfering. Stage we're pretty much ready to go, so my next job is now to check for fuel leaks. I'm going to turn the fuel pump on. Now at this stage I really don't want the throttle cable connected, nor the slow running cable, and all the various instructions kind of assume that you've already got the engine warmed up for the carburettor adjustment, so we need to get to that stage. As I say, it's a nice warm day, so I think it's going to start. The coolant temperature showing about 30 degrees Celsius, which is quite possible, it's been in the sun all day. So well, I have found that I can poke a screwdriver through there and I can just get the jet to drop slightly on the slow running control, probably just enough to get us started on the front carburettor and warming up. So I'm going to try that. I think, as I've said, at this stage you don't want the interconnection shafts attached at all. There's no oil in the dampers at the moment, that doesn't matter. So we'll do our leak check now. But at this stage we do not want the air cleaners on, and to have the slow running control we need the air cleaners on for one of the brackets. Didn't actually show the fuel pump in situ, did I, in the previous video? So just checking around for leaks now, but there is a new fuel pump. Can't see any weeps at the moment. I'm just going to leave the car and stand 5 or 10 minutes. I'll turn the ignition again, see if it wants to top the system up, which might suggest that there is a leak, but so far so good. Important ones to keep an eye on are right under the float chambers, where those gland nuts go in with the new jet tubes. But can't smell any fuel, so I think we're all good. Yeah, it's pretty good. Well, as you can see, temperature gauge is just slightly off the stop, so I think we'll go for a start. I reckon we stand a pretty good chance. Let's see what happens.
Well, that was easy. So we just let her stand and warm up now.
Okay, so I was fairly careful with my initial adjustment. I'll just show you what you need to do this.
This is the front carburettor. And then the rear. Quite a difference in the gauge there. About another 10 millimetres up the gauge. Obviously you can hear the idle speed coming up as the engine warms up, but it's lumpy. I'd say a bit lean at the moment. Let's find out. Yeah, so a bit lean on both. It's really interesting just seeing how little work that fuel pump's doing. Really surprised. Well, I think we want just a little more warmth yet. Oil pressure's good though. I don't know if I've shown you my keyring. It's for opening the cowlings on Spitfires, not Triumphs. Proper Spitfires. Just to get us somewhere in the right ballpark, I'm just going to try and get the mixture on each carburettor somewhere near. We'll then try and get the idle as near as possible, what we want, and then do the synchronisation.
About there now. If I lift the test buttons,
well listen, you should just hear the engine speed up then slow again slightly. And roughly the same either side, just slightly. So fully up to temperature, I think we can now do the synchronisation. more tweaking to do, but I think we're nearly there, so you get the idea. Sounding a little better, but still smelling a bit rich, so I reckon we'll have to do the final tune-up after a good long drive. It's a lot better for now though. I'm going to stop the engine and set the throttle into connections.
Well, I think I'll do this next bit off film because you simply won't see it with my hands in the way. But this is the throttle interconnection. So these are free on the shaft at the moment. And this here is a slow running control shaft. And there needs to be a clearance between this lever here and that shaft. Now for these, a car like this with a synchromesh gearbox, it's 12 thou between rod and lever. So we've got a 12 thou feeler gauge to set that, which we'll simply push in there. You get the idea. And it's 20 thou for automatic cars. So what we're going to do is set these levers in there while they're loose, push them down so they just rest on the lower part of the throttle fork, like so, and then we're going to push that down and place the feeler gauge in there, making sure the throttles are still shut, and then we'll nip up those clamp bolts, and that way there'll always be a clearance at the forks. It's very important. And it just stops the throttle being actuated by the car moving, or the engine rather, moving on the mounts, which, you know, could give you a kangarooing effect. So that's what that's all about. Alright, with those clamps locked up, there is now always a clearance, just a slight bit before the lever starts to open the throttle. I should have said the clearance should be here. It doesn't need a clearance here. This arm stops against that rod. That's fine. So you can see now why I recommended putting that spring on the throttle interconnection first. I just hooked up the throttle cable and reminded myself that the one thing I dislike about this car is the feel at the throttle pedal. It's really heavy and it just feels really dry, if you know what I mean. Like something in the system needs oiling. So I've just put some light machine oil and graphite paste mixed up down that piece of tube there, and I'll let it soak through, work the cable a bit. Should never stick. I learned that one after having a handbrake cable stick on a prehistoric Volkswagen Passat halfway across France. Never ever gave any more trouble. Graphite's wonderful stuff. So the cold running interconnections are now set. They're not quite so critical, but I've set them so that they're set hard up against the working side, as it were. And we'll make sure there's some slack in the actuating cable. And the throttle's now set to. And I'll make sure that the cable is actually fairly tight, so there's probably just a, say, a 30 seconds free play at the pedal. Having set the throttle cable and the interconnection, I've just started the car and once again check the synchronisation with the meter, and it's still spot on. I'm now just going to top up the dashpots with oil. I'm going to fill these to within, well, half inch above the top of the piston rod with the normal vented caps. So to set up the slow running control and cold running control rather, it's necessary to have the front airbox on so that you get this bracket in situ. So there's this pin here on the cable outer, which is actually what does the actuating, and it attaches to that little brass bronze lever down there. And then there's a cable clamp which goes in that hole there. Let's put that in a safe place. So I've got to go and find it now. The oil down that throttle cable has made a world of difference. It feels so much better. Might have overdone it slightly, but very much nicer. There we are, that's the little widget. That goes through the hole in the bracket. And I think we'll have a new spring as well. Again, there was a little point in me filming this, really. You really not see it once my hands are in there working. So you can see the position of the cold running control lever, which is just across from the front carburettor fork there. There is a little bracket which I think was originally for the return spring to go on, but the return spring seems a lot happier on that forked lever between there and the heat shield, so I've gone with that and just put a washer on there instead. It seems to look better as well. If I ever do find out how it exactly should go, it's not quite clear from the parts books, I'll put it right. Anyway, so I've connected the little cable ferrule up to the bracket, and there is just a little bit of free play there, so it will remain shut. I'm now going to pull the choke control on the dashboard out just until the jets begin to drop. And what I'll then do is work out where I want the high idle adjustment set. Now I've just pulled the choke cable out until I felt resistance, and that's these jet tubes just want to start moving at this point. So as you can hopefully see, these cams have come round a little bit. So now what I'm doing, what I have done, is just to wind these high idle adjustment screws in just until they touch the cam. What I'm going to do now is let the choke control back into the dash, give them another half turn in, and that should give us a high idle. That's a starting point.
Running, or high idle rather, cold running, high idle, higher idle, and obviously choke. Might need some adjustment, but we'll have to do that when it's cold. Probably a little over adjusted at the moment. Something else to fix. It's sounding a lot sweeter though.
Well, I think there's a bit of final tweaking to do. I'm quite sure that I'll be road testing it at some point. Next time I have to go to work, I'll probably head out really early in the morning and get that done.
It seems to pick up well. Settled the oil nicely. The tremendous stink of fuel is gone. It's really nice. Very pleased about that. Yeah, it's not too bad. Maybe just slightly on the rich side, I reckon. But as I say, can't really do anything about that until it's properly hot after a good drive.
My little key fob earlier, the very fastener tool, which I said was for Spitfire cowlings, and so it is. It's also a bottle opener. Keeping our RAF going in those years was hard work, thirsty work. It's also got a little 2BA and 4BA spanner on the other end and a pry bar. But yeah, this is what it's for, because these are a very similar fixing to those that hold particularly Spitfire and Hurricane cowlings and hatches on. So, makes a cool but functional key ring for your MG. There we are, it's sounding very much better than it was. And looking very much tidier under there too. Had a good look round, I can't find any fuel leaks. And the most noticeable thing is the smell of fuel is gone. The car always stank of fuel inside and out. And I think that was a combination of the leaking fuel pump, old fuel lines, and the various leaks on the carburettors. So very much better all round. Well worth the effort.